This is a dynamic stress test. Here we're going to cycle this at a known load. In this case, they're controlling strain, and we're going to cycle it until it fails. These tests are part of what we're going to make up our material curve tests, namely the SN curve. So what we're going to do is we're going to take specimens, we're going to cycle them at a load level, and we're going to count the cycles to failure. And as no surprise, the higher the load we cycle at, the lower the cycles to failure. So an SN curve is cycles to failure from a constant amplitude load test. Now, and what we test is these machine smooth specimens, and they all have variation. So even though we test at the same load, typical would be like at least 3 by 5, the minimum. At least 3 samples, 5 loads, but that's pretty small. That would be a bare minimum to try to extrapolate a curve. So we test multiple samples at a given load level and we get a distribution. So when you get your SN curve, typically it's the 50th percentile. In some packages I've seen, you can set like 90th or 10th percentile. Okay, so just typically we're using the 50th percentile curve. So there is a lot of these coupon testing machines, they cycle. One of the challenges is if you really want to get it at the very low amplitude cycles, these tests can take a long time. For stress life, there is just a wealth of material out there on SN curve, and you can buy databases. For strain life, it's not so easy to get, and sometimes you have to run your own tests. Okay, so the SN curve, we do a fit. Our durability headquarters for technology is in Germany. So we got a little German on the slides. We're going to have different regions of the SN curve. The one in the middle is the elastic region. Please don't take these as literal. I've seen the elastic region start at 1,000 or 10,000, end at 1 million or 10 million. Okay, elastic region is where we have a linear relationship between stress and strain. And generally, we're going to use something called stress life. The plastic region, even though it looks big, it's still only 10,000 or 1,000 cycles. This is where we have a nonlinear relationship between stress and strain, and we're going to use something called strain life. We can also use strain life in this region because it's a combination of the EN curve has the SN curve built into it. And then we have the infinite life region. If we keep the stress below this level, we never accumulate damage. Just be real careful about the infinite life, because the theory also says that if I go above this level one time, then I have damage down here. So that's the infinite life region. We'll talk about it, not all materials have an infinite life. So again, this just puts some of these points, and these are qualitative approximations. So this can change a lot of the areas, like the ultimate strength, we fail at one cycle. Okay, we're generally going to see an SN curve. I've always seen it on a log scale because we like straight lines. They're easier to work with than on this linear scale. But you can see here we have a big curve here. We have a straight line. I want to spend a little time on this slide because it's just to make you aware of there's a couple of coefficients and they're used differently by different people. So I just want to warn you about it. Bastens Law is the formula for an SN curve. Okay. So there's two formulations, number of cycles times stress to this coefficient equals C. And then this one, the stress times this constant here times N raised to the B, which is the number of cycles. Okay, these are the two formulations. In this formulation, B is a number between 3 and 12. So in our products, we use this in our mission synthesis or accelerated testing module. So if you see B between 3 and 12, you're generally looking at this formulation. If you see B between minus 0.33 and 0.0833, then you're looking at this formulation. And then sometimes, like you'll see if you add our software, you do a fatigue analysis, we'll call this number K. So it's minus 1/B. It's a little bit easier to, you know, think in numbers, SN curve slopes between 3 and 12, but technically the slope is a number like this, 0.33 to 0.083. So I just want to make you aware of that. So here I have a couple of B's, or in this formulation, it would be the K. And you see the run here? So the bigger this number is, the flatter the line is. Here, the steeper the slope is. So the steeper the slope, generally when we do accelerated testing, these lower B's are more conservative with this formulation. Typical rule of thumb we always want to keep in mind is the ultimate endurance limit are off by a factor of 2 on steels. It's important whenever you think about increasing the I can run this test faster by increasing the amplitude. Please keep this in mind. You're raising the amplitude by 1.1 or 1.2%. Now, there's also this flat line. We talked about it. Can be called the fatigue limit or endurance limit. It's basically on steels, ferrous alloys, titanium alloys. Aluminum doesn't have it. I'll show you a picture of what aluminum looks like, but it just kind of continues to slope down. Now, if you don't have these materials, in the software, there's something called the Uniform Material Law or Universal Slope Law. There's been research done, and you can generate EN and SN curves from these two parameters, Young's modulus and the ultimate tensile strength. Now, for typical automotive steels, maybe okay. The aerospace people don't particularly like the Uniform Material Law. But it is a way, if you have no place to start, where you can start with material properties. Here's aluminum. So here's an example of an SN curve for aluminum versus a steel. And here again is our typical steel, 0.5 of the UTS. So the UTS to the endurance limit is 0.5. So don't, if you're operating anywhere around the endurance limit and you multiply by 2, that's a really, really, really big change in fatigue. So how do we get this damage? Well, we got the SN curve, and that tells us cycles to failure at a constant amplitude load test. So we can take the cycles, we can measure the amplitude, go over here to the SN curve, divide the number of cycles by the amplitude to failure, in that case, 0.33. Take another cycle, that's a bigger amplitude, lower cycles to failure, 2 cycles at 4, that's 0.55. It's a linear damage model, so the math is pretty easy. We just add that together and get 0.83. Now, Miner told us it fails at 1, so this doesn't fail. If we added another cycle, we would get to failure. Some people, as a factor of safety, they maybe say, hey, I'm going to make this damage sum not 1, but 0.9 or something. But this is the basic theory. This is how we do damage. Here's a more of a mathematical expression, and probably give credit to credit due. It's called Palmgren-Miner's rule, but a lot of times we just see Miner's rule. Now, just to let you know, K, so K is that number that's like the B in the other one, so K of 5, and I have a 15% change in a load, I reduce my life by 50%. So reducing a cycle loading applied to an optimal shaped steel component with 13% doubles the life. And that's this formulation. Okay, you can see it as a function of K. So as that line gets flatter, the load has a bigger effect. SN curves has adjustments. They have adjustments for size, surface finish, mean stress, and loading. Okay, so we'll just switch these curves. The thing you want to pay attention to is not the stress concentration factor, but this fatigue notch factor. It's generally between 1 and the stress concentration factor, and it will allow us to shift this down to handle things like surface finish or size corrections or stuff like that. And literature can help you with this. I have a little plug in here for some textbooks that we took the diagram from. Okay, mean stress, there's 2 ways to handle it. Some people shift the SN curve, we adjust the cycle in the rainfall matrix. Okay, but mean stress could also possibly do that. Not covered here are surface treatments like heat treating and shot peening and stuff like that, which could also affect the SN curve.